Welcome to Now Church. We are about to begin. Please take this opportunity to pull out your smartphone so you can like, share, and check in on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag NowChurch. Thank you, and enjoy today's service.
Together, and we honor you, and we will praise you in every circumstance, in every situation. God, you are worthy. So we set our hearts upon you, and we give you the highest praise that you deserve today. I know you're in the building, but let me hear you real good. Let me hear you real good. Real good. Come on. There you are. Gotta shout. believers in the house. Our God is faithful. Yes, He is. Faithful all my life. Praise. Just say this with me. Jesus, I thank you for this moment, and you are worthy of all the glory. So I give it to you now. Come on, if you really mean that, could you give him one more praise?
Oh,
church. Building, I wonder if you could give him worship from your own heart this morning. It's always the interesting time during the holiday season. I'm grateful that I know that joy is not just a feeling, but it's a truth that we have by the word of God. And we get to choose in every moment how to set our hearts and our affections. And I know this time can be tricky for people, especially during the seasons. How many of you are grateful that the joy of the Lord can be a consistent thing in your heart because God doesn't change? Does everybody believe that today? Come on. His presence is faithful. So sing it with me from your heart. Say it. Say, the joy. Sing it. The joy. The joy of the Lord. It's your strength today. Say, joy. Oh. You're my hope in the storm, God. The joy, the joy, the joy of the Lord is my strength. So we worship you, Jesus. Without lyrics on the screen, let your heart adore him. Let your heart adore him. We worship you, Jesus. Singers, if you could, let's just lead them in worship today. Lift your voices, God. We worship you, Jesus. Have your way in this place. There's no place I'd rather be. There's no place I'd rather be than in your presence.
Jesus. Jesus, your presence is the comfort of my soul.
Yeah. sing it together. There's nowhere you say, there's nowhere I'd rather be. Come on, church. When you're soon. church. You sing it. Say nothing's too hard. That's right.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Good morning, right? I'm glad you sing it high so I can get that low part in there so that works out. So, you know what? I'm reminded about something. As we're coming in here and we're coming through the rain, guess what? There are churches right now in this very time zone that are going through snow or sleet. Listen, people. I served hard time as a senior pastor for 3 years in Michigan. And I got off on good behavior and God brought me back to Florida. Thank God. Thank the Lord for Now Church and Pastor Richard, Pastor Gail. Having me back is amazing. But listen, I remember we would get up on Sunday mornings and this Florida boy would look out and see this beautiful, pristine snow sometimes. Sometimes it's just sleet. And I would get out, and I didn't have a garage at the place I'm at. So I get out, and I have a scraper. Some of you don't even know what a scraper is. You have to turn on your car early. Otherwise, you try to get it. You can't get in it because it's frozen shut. Some of you remember this? How many Northerners, transplant people, do we have? You're like, yeah, that's right. And then when it was snowing, then there would be people that wouldn't come to church because it was snow, and I would be drifting in. Why? Because the presence of God is that important to be here. And everyone that went through the snow and the sleet, they were there and they worshiped God. And let me just tell you, this is not to make you feel bad, but us Floridians, right? We had the weather alert yesterday. It was the great I wouldn't say sleet, it was like slight showers of 2023 yesterday. A horrible blizzard. No, see the point? You have to purpose to press in. We have to purpose to arrive, we have to purpose to bring our spirit and open up our spirit to see the most of this moment. Right? We only have 52 of these a year, and we make the very most of every Sunday service as we're gathering together. And here's the thing, I'm going somewhere with this. There are people all around us that we've been praying for that know that, listen, that they are disconnected from church. They don't have a reason to get up on a Sunday morning like this to get somewhere. They don't have that sense of urgency because they don't know what they're missing. But we can be praying for them that the Spirit of God can warm their heart and stir them to come. This is the third week that I've heard from someone that mentioned their meeting their neighbor outside talking to them, and their neighbor, who they've been praying for, said, you know, I've just been thinking about coming to church. And it's the very thing that they're praying for. It's showing you that the Spirit of God, as you start praying, He starts working. and hearts and lives and people that need to be here desperately. This service, maybe it'll be tonight's service, whatever it's going to be. Maybe you're here first time. I met a few people that are here first time. Maybe people prayed for you. Well, because we love you and we care for you and we're glad that you made this time to come today. And we pray this is going to be a God moment for you. Let's pray right now. Father, we thank you for the church that you have blessed us with. And we don't take it for granted. We don't take it lightly that you've built such an incredible place of worshipers, of God lovers, of people that are hearers and doers of the word of God, of people that press into you and have a personal relationship with you. We thank you for this atmosphere that you've given us to steward, to manage. And Father, we ask you, Lord, that we press in today to make the very most of today. And Father, we pray, Lord, as our spirits are open, we pray for those, Lord, that are wandering, those that are out, Lord, wandering, those that are isolated, those that are alone. Father, we pray that your spirit would stir in their hearts, those that we're believing for this end of the year challenge. God, we pray that you'd work in their hearts, in their spirits, stir in them, warm them up like no one else can. Draw them close, Lord. Bring them beyond every hesitancy and every excuse that would keep them from the house of God. And Father, we ask you that you draw them in for your glory to change their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's give God a big praise. Bigger than the weather, bigger than the overcast. It's overcast outside. It's not overcast over you. Amen? That's awesome. Listen, I want you to turn around, put your best sunshiny face on, turn around, welcome somebody right around you, and we're going to continue in a second. So it's good to see all you guys buzzing, meeting everybody and everything. We're so glad that you are here. We have so many things that we want to share with you. This Christmas season has become very busy for us, and we've got a lot of stuff that we want to highlight and let you know. As we said before, we have this segment of In the Know. It's just to let everybody know what's happening with different pockets and ministries. Maybe you weren't involved in these, but we want you to know about them, so maybe you get involved next time. So anyways, one of the first things that came up this last week, we were preparing, last couple weeks, we were asking you to go over and pick up some hearts next door of some family members, kids and family members, and you were able to take that and sponsor a family and buy gifts for them. So this last week, if we show you these pictures here of all of the gifts that you guys bless people with and bringing them into church. They're just going to keep rolling these pictures. But we had a bunch of gifts given and it all separated and put together for these different families. And then we loaded up this truck. We've been partnering with Pay It Forward Ministries, and that was their truck outside. So we loaded that up and it's going out right now, even this week, last week and this week, it's going out to bless families for Christmas. So I want you to give it up for what God did through us together. Come on, making a difference, blessing people's lives. We're able to share this with them and just let them know that someone loves them, cares for them, that God, Jesus, loves them and cares for them, so it's a good thing. And then the next thing that happened that evening, our youth gathered together for their Christmas banquet. So if you guys put that up there, they had a great time. It was one of their best events, they said. Pastor Tristan just raved about it. We had so many youth gathering together, so they had a lot of food, sweets, and great times, games, and all that stuff. Listen, if you were not, yeah, it was, yes, fa-la-la lasagna, by the way. So they had a nice Italian feast, and so that's always good. So anyway, so listen, we love Now Youth. We love our youth here at this church. We think they're incredible young people of God, and they're doing incredible things, and it's so good to have them gathered together. So if you're not involved in our youth ministry, make sure you get involved because a lot of stuff is happening with that. One more, give it up one more time for our Now Youth. Show them the love. They're awesome. And then this last Friday night, we gathered together. Some of our team, our MVP, our men's group, gathered together, and we built Christmas bikes for different people. This was part of our outreach. We had a lot of bikes that are given, and sometimes they are assembled at Walmart. And anyway, so we fix their fixing, and we assembled some of them right out of the box. We had a time where we just gathered together, the men, just a good fellowship. We ate a little bit, and then we just hung out, talked, and built, and built, and built, and had a great time. So all of these bikes, they are also part of the outreach, going to families that were in need, and we're able to really bless them to have a really good Christmas. Again, so they know someone's thinking about them, someone loves them, someone cares for them. Isn't that awesome? So again, I want to give it up for Men of Vision and Purpose, our men's group, making a difference. That's really cool. All right. If you're new to Now Church, we're glad that you came here today. Like I said, I met a few of you that are here the first time. So I want to encourage you. Thank you for coming. It's exciting to have you here. We don't like to point you out and you know, make you nervous or anything, but we do ask you after the service, please go by our Welcome Center. It's our area of guest experience, is what we call it. Go by there, and they have some stuff that they want to bless you with and encourage you with. Just some free gifts to let you know we're thinking about you and just to keep Now Church on your mind, because we want you to do something different. It's called our 3-week challenge. You're here the first week, but we ask you, check out Now Church 3 weeks in a row and see what God does. We've seen this over and over as someone steps in and they give God just a little room, then he starts really working. If you give God more room, he starts really working in a greater way. Then you start seeing patterns of how God is speaking to you through the worship, through the services. Just give God as much room in this time to change your life. How's that? Is that good? All right. If you will, welcome with me Pastor Richard as he continues on this series.
Amen. Glad that you're here today. The accounting department has asked me to receive an offering every time that we have rain for our new covering between the buildings. We see 2024 a covering over our courtyard. I'm not really doing a fundraiser today for that. That's just what the accounting department says every time it rains. Hey, it's a good week for you to raise money for the covering because people are getting wet. Anyway, right now we're empowering the Umbrella Brigade, and we're thankful for our greeters. They're going to get you back and forth if it is raining when you're leaving and when you're coming. Anyway, continuing our thought this month, Cradle, Cross, and Crown, and continuing, today's message is called Tidings of Comfort and Joy. I want to get right into that. I want to remind you, and I want to please get the word out to all your friends that are part of the church. Next Sunday is Christmas Eve Day, and we're doing one combined service. It's going to be packed, but we're going to do one combined service at 10 a.m., Think of our summer hours when we did that. That's kind of what we do for holidays around here. So please get the word out. One service next week. What time? 10 a.m. So you guys get an extra hour to sleep in. And the 11 o'clock service, they have to get up. Anyway, we're glad that you're watching today. And let's get right into the inerrant, the inspired, the infallible word of the living God. We stand on the word. We trust the word. The word is true. It is God speaking to and through people. And so we're going to look at Luke chapter 24, verse 13 in the beginning. This is the story of after Jesus' resurrection, and they find the tomb empty. The disciples are starting to discover that he's alive. And one of the stories that Luke tells is an eyewitness account of two of the disciples on a walk. Luke 24, 13. Now behold, two of the disciples were traveling that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they talked together of all these things which had happened. So it was while they conversed and reasoned. First I thought when I read that they were in converses, but I guess that wasn't invented yet. It says they conversed and reasoned that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. I don't know if my mic is right here. Anyway, look at verse 16. But their eyes were restrained, so they did not know him. They didn't recognize him. They didn't understand it was him. And he said to them, what kind of conversation is this that you have with one another as you walk and are sad? I want to ask you today, what kind of conversations are you having in this time of year? Because we've said that this can be among the most difficult times emotionally for people, because they're grieving over the past or pining away for things that have come and gone. What kind of conversations are you having with one another as you walk and talk? Now, skip down to verse 24. This is from the Message version. Some of our friends went off to the tomb. They're talking to Jesus here. Some of our friends went off to the tomb to check out and found it empty, just as the women said, but they didn't see Jesus. Then he said to them, "So thick-headed, so slow-hearted, why can't you simply believe?" Everybody say that with me. Simply believe. Say it again. Simply believe. Why can't you simply believe all the prophets said? Don't you see that these things had to happen? That the Messiah had to suffer and only then enter his glory? Then he started at the beginning with the books of Moses and went on through all the prophets, pointing out everything in the Old Testament scriptures that referred to himself. Very important. I want to weave in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3. Paul the Apostle writes, "But I fear lest somehow, as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, so your minds may be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ." The simplicity that is in Christ. Let's pray one more time. Father God, would you open the eyes of our heart? We thank you, Jesus, for your life. Thank you, Lord, for your human experience to identify with us in your life and in your death, that you're raised up the third day and filling us with that resurrection power today. We thank you today that everything that's been dead or sleeping will one day come back to life. We see it coming back to life in Jesus' name. Amen. We talked about Advent last week. It's a traditional thing that churches do to observe as a lead up to Christmas, but the word Advent, we said, means an expectation or arrival. It's about an anticipation, waiting exceedingly for something or waiting excitedly for something to happen or someone to arrive. We gave you Lamentations 3:25 from the Message, very powerful. This one verse, God proves to be good to the man who passionately waits, to the woman who diligently seeks. We said last week, there is a passive kind of waiting where you're just kind of waiting for something to happen and kind of looking around. And some people call that faith. That's not faith. That's denial. You're just kind of looking around and hoping, but faith is the substance of what you hope for. Faith is the knowing that God is going to come through. You might not know the way or the timing he's going to come through, but you know he's going to come through. As we sang a few moments ago, he's going to make a way because he is the way. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Can you say amen? Amen. We said that there's a passive way of waiting or there's a passionate way of waiting, and that the word waiting in the Old Testament in the Hebrew is, we told you the story of the war eagles and the weapons of war. If you weren't here last week or you didn't get to watch last week, I encourage you to watch last week. We had probably one of the biggest reactions of the year. People responded to that story and to that message. So please look online. You can get it anytime you want. To wait upon the Lord, according to Isaiah 40, to wait upon the, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be weary. They shall run and not faint. All those things that were said there. I think I just said it backwards. But anyway, you know what it is. It's to braid. The word wait means to braid yourself or entwine yourself. They that entwine themselves with God, they that wrap themselves in him, become his eagles. Amen. Now, when we spoke about the holidays the last few weeks being difficult for some people who are prone to bouts of depression, I got to thinking about sentimentality. I mean, it really is a time, my wife and I were just on last night, about memories we have as kids, just warm memories of how big a deal it was when our grandparents would arrive with the presence. Her grandparents and my grandparents were from similar age, similar time, similar parts of the country, Pennsylvania and South Jersey. And so they all kind of had the same traditions. She called her grandparents Nana and Pop-Pop, and I called my grandparents Nana and Pop-Pop, which when we met in high school, that was a big deal. Because we were down in Florida, where we were in the land of Meemaw and Peepaw and Papaw and Mamaw and, you know, all these things. So we're like, hey, somebody else speaks Pennsylvania. This is cool. And so anyway, we kind of got along in that, and it was a big deal. My grandparents, when they would arrive, and they moved to Florida by the time I was an early teenager, and lived about, you know, 20, 30 minutes from us. They had their own church, their own flow, their own way. But they would show up on Christmas Day. We'd have private kind of mourning with the family. And then my grandparents would show up and they'd bring, I don't know if you remember those old wicker baskets that made out of straw or made out of wood. And they'd bring these big wicker baskets full of presents for everybody. And it was a big, huge deal when they would arrive. And we just anticipated, you know, a lot of those people, I mean, we had aunts and uncles and cousins. My grandfather was a Methodist pastor, and he was the youngest of seven kids in the Perinchief side. And my grandmother, his wife, my Nana Perinchief, she was the youngest of nine. So we had aunts and uncles like crazy. And so some of them would come in, and most of them didn't have kids of their own for whatever reason, and so there weren't a lot of cousins by the dozens, but there were aunts and uncles coming in. And all those people are gone now. And so it's easy to kind of get caught up in the sentiment of the time. There's nothing wrong with a little bit of holiday nostalgia, an occasional momentary peek to those Christmases long, long ago in the song Most Wonderful Time of the Year. But I submit to you, when I thought about this, what are we actually looking for? We're not looking to go back. We're not looking to go backwards. We don't. There's nothing back there that I want to redo, even if I could. But I submit to you that maybe it's the feeling we had when life was just simpler. That life had, that when you're a child, the wonder of a child, that childlike faith Jesus speaks of, is not about being childish. It's about being childlike. It's about wonder. It's about simplicity. That you knew certain things were going to happen, you could count on those things. Maybe it's just me, but since the turn of the century, and that sounds crazy, it seems to have become a lot more complex. Those of you that are still in that childlike wonder, maybe those of you that are teenagers and stuff, I mean, you don't have any recollection of before the year 2000, but the Y2K thing going into 9/11, going into the great global recession of 2008 that was so painful, the worldwide COVID pandemic, some of you, that's all you remember, but it's a lot to navigate. Spiritually, mentally, emotionally. I did a series years ago called Whatever Happened to Mayberry. We talked about the pace of our lives and just appreciating the simplicity of being grateful for every blessing every day. The Bible says, but when you pray, pray this way. Jesus said, give us this day our daily bread. That's simple. And around our leadership team, we say something all the time. We say this phrase that we learned years ago, simplify to strengthen. If you get overwhelmed and everything starts to be so complicated, so complex, and you're overthinking everything, there are moments where you just have to simplify. There are moments when you get too many clothes in the closet that you haven't worn in 3 years. I guess it's just me. And you look there and you think, well, someday, when somebody, if they're in good shape, one of the great things that working with Pastor Benny Hinn taught me was, while stuff is still nice, sow it to somebody else and watch for your harvest. People used to, you know, everywhere I go, because I used to work with Benny Hinn back in the day, some of you newer people don't even know that, or some of you don't even know who he is, but back in the day, We were youth pastors in Orlando Christian Center back in the 80s. We were with that ministry from late 1986 until 1990 when we were sent out to start Spirit Life, which is now called Now Church. And everywhere I go in the world, people that find that out, they always want to say, was he for real? Was that real? The healing and the falling and the this and the that, was it real? Can I just tell you something? Not only was it real, but people get upset because Pastor Benny lives a little bit of a blessed lifestyle more than you can handle. They get upset because of his suits and there's this and the. Let me just tell you something. The most generous person I've ever met in my life is Benny Hinn. I went to his house dozens of times, and I never left his house without armloads of blessings of things he wanted to give us. Every time. We had a tradition that I loved because back in the 80s, he was buying these nice ties and I was buying Burlington Coat Factory ties. And, you know, where you get them, you know, 10 ties for $100, you know. And he was buying these nice silk ties from overseas that were probably pretty expensive. But you know what happened? When we'd have pastors' meetings, we'd go to the house sometimes for the holidays or different parties, and we'd go there into his house, and he'd say, at the end of the time, he'd say, oh, guys, I've got two ties laid out across my bed for each one of you. Go. And these were grown men, but you couldn't tell it by. We were roller derbying down the hall and jumping onto this bed at the end of this long runway and grabbing ties, and I want that one. No, that one's mine. The generosity is the key to unlock everything else. I don't know how I got off on that subject, but it's important you know that today. Simplify to strengthen. Streamline stuff when it gets too complicated. When you get too much, give some away. That's the point. Do something. And listen, when you make room, you'll be surprised at what God does to bless you back anyway. So today, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. That's what the scripture says. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord, the anointed one and his anointing. My friends, we need to get back to simply believing and receiving the promises of God. The promises of God are there for you. When Jesus was crucified, dead, and buried, the disciples wanted to shock. And they thought their hopes for salvation were gone and buried forever. But they could not see the big picture. They couldn't possibly understand what God was up to. They couldn't understand resurrection power when it didn't seem like he was there. Even though, by the way, he was there, they just couldn't see it was him because he chose to block that view. How many times in your life and mine is God up to something, but our view is blocked? We don't see it's him until afterward. We see it later when all the puzzle pieces are there and it can make sense to us. Jesus walked with a couple of discouraged, defeated disciples, and he challenged their sad conversation. You're so quiet today. Did rain dampen your tongue? Man, Pastor Lindsay, were you up here fighting dragons? Man, I'm telling you, it's like pulling a tooth just because there's a little bit of rain. Like Pastor Chris said, you didn't get the snow. They couldn't see the big picture. He challenged their sad conversation. And he challenged it not just by saying, why are you guys being so negative? That's not what he said. He challenged their conversation when they were saying about Jesus was gone, that he was dead, that they saw him and their hope was dashed. He spoke to them with truth. Truth to hang your hat on. Not legendary fables, but the word of God. He gave them the world's greatest Bible study. By the way, that 7-mile walk from Jerusalem to Emmaus, it is said to have taken 3 hours each way. When they're on this walk, they had 3 hours with Jesus Christ, giving them the most powerful Bible study they'd ever had. He gave them, he is the living word, and he gave them the word from the word. He gave them, the Bible says, he started with Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, called the Torah, the first 5 books of the Bible, the books of Moses. Moses wrote those 5. He took him through Moses. He took him through the prophets. He gave him, he showed them messianic Jesus revelation before. He took them on that road right there to Emmaus. He took them on the road to truth. He took them on the road to what would break through their darkness, which is the Word of God. And as he spoke the word from the word, the Bible says they started to see it was him. Later on, the Bible says that when they were conversing, they said, wasn't our heart strangely warmed when he spoke that word that was within us? Wasn't our heart, weren't our hearts strangely warmed as he spoke the word? We knew it was him, but we didn't know it was it. We didn't see it. Their eyes were enlightened. One of my favorite scriptures, a life scripture for me, is in Ephesians 1. It says, it's a prayer of Paul where he says, I'm praying that you would have the spirit of wisdom and the spirit of revelation, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened. And the word enlightened there in the Greek word is the word photizo, P-H-O-T-I-Z-O, photizo, from which we get the word photograph. I'm praying that your eyes of your heart would begin to see the images. What happens when you're going through a dark place? When you're, you know, a dark room, you go and develop negatives and turn them into photos of what you can see. That's revelation knowledge. That's when you're reading the Bible and you read something that you read 1,000 times and you got something or nothing from, and all of a sudden it lifts off the page and hits your spirit as a rhema word, and God opens your eyes and you see it and you understand and you get something out of it you never got before. That's one of the glories of this time, is that our God is alive, and that as he speaks, light bulbs go off in your heart and in your mind. And you can begin to take these times that you're going through and turn them into, from negatives into positives, from negatives into photos of what God is up to. He said, I'm praying that your eyes would be open, that you would develop the inward pictures of what God has said about you, of what God is doing, that you would know the hope of your calling and the glory of his inheritance in the saints. My friends, you have an inheritance. You're part of his family. Don't shout me down too much. He, with the help of the Holy Spirit, Jesus revealed all the Old Testament scriptures that were about him. Jesus is in the Bible from Genesis to Malachi, not just the New Testament. Jesus is there in foreshadowing. One recent Bible scholar estimated that the Old Testament contained over 2,500 prophetic references to the expected Jewish Messiah. 2,500 different puzzle pieces in the Old Testament that pointed to the Messiah and pointed to the fact that he would suffer and pointed to the fact that he'd be buried and pointed to the fact that he would go into the ground and pointed to the fact that he would rise the third day. The phrase the third day, by the way, is throughout Scripture. That there's a third day resurrection, that just when it looks like it's hopeless, our God rises up in the midst of it. And the interesting thing, of 2,500 prophetic references, Jesus of Nazareth is the only possible person that fulfilled every single prophecy. It can be no other. And the only reason why Jewish people today don't understand that is because they're still blocked. The Bible says they can't see what they can't see. But there's coming an unveiling for them as well. prophecy is looking ahead backwards. Seems kind of an oxymoron. Prophecy is looking ahead backwards. When you look, when you can look back at the prophetic words, prophecy put the puzzle pieces on the table, but no human could have possibly seen how they would come together the way they did. Even, I just give you an example in the time we have. Listen to this. Even where Messiah would come from, we all know that Mary went into labor in Bethlehem, the city of David. But did you know Micah chapter 5 verse 2 says in the Old Testament, but you Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of you shall come forth to me the one to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth are from old, from everlasting. Micah chapter 5 verse 2 tells us he's going to be born in Bethlehem. Now, you have to understand, this is a big deal. Jesus just so happened to be born in Bethlehem because of a Roman Empire government census that required people to go to their family hometown. The family was living in the Galilee, days travel away from Jerusalem, days travel away from Bethlehem. Jerusalem is kind of between, Bethlehem's on the other side, on the south side of Jerusalem, and Galilee's way on the north side, northeast side of Jerusalem, way far away. So many different things had to happen. It's interesting. Egypt, in Egypt, listen, when King Herod decided to have the Jewish boys under 2 years of age to be killed, remember the wise men came from the east? By the way, it never says three wise men, and it never gives their name. They do that at the Radio City Rockefeller Center Christmas story. But there's no scripture that says Belshazzar and all these names. These three wise men came. We three kings of Orient are smoking on a rubber cigar. We used to say that. Anyway, that was good. Anyway, sorry. Anyway, that was a child regression. Anyway, it was a massive amount of wise men that came from the east because it attracted. It wasn't three guys coming in with a couple camels. They brought gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Doesn't mean they brought one piece of gold, one piece of frankincense, one piece of myrrh. No. They brought in enough that the king, Herod, said, what's going on? What are these guys doing in town, and why didn't they come see me? So he brings them in. He says, why are you here? They said, we came because the stars told us. We saw it in the heavens that there was going to be a king born, the king of the Jews. And he said, and we know that Jesus was under the age of two at this point because Herod, we don't know what time. See, a lot of the traditions we see in the manger scene, the shepherds came by watch of night in the beginning. But the Bible doesn't say the timeline of the wise men from the east, but we assume that Jesus was under 2 years of age because Herod issued the decree, kill all the baby boys under two. So this is a whole thing. We got to get between the tradition. We got to get in the Word. We got to find what the Word says, because the Word is true. And so what happens is, at that point, there's a warning that comes. See, Hosea 11:1 says this, when Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. That's Old Testament. Jesus went to Egypt because his family was told in a dream, an angel actually appeared to Joseph, his stepfather, his Mary's husband, his father of his earthly father. And it says in Matthew 2:13, now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. This is when the wise men came. It says the wise men departed, and they snuck out to get away from Herod themselves. And behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, arise, take the young child and his mother, flee to Egypt. Stay there until I bring you word, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. Understand that right there, that this was a moment where God says, okay, I want him in Egypt. Well, the Old Testament said that he would come from Egypt. He would come from Bethlehem. But he'd also come from Egypt. Well, how did that happen? The other part of this is Jesus had to retrace the steps, in a way, of the journey, the 40-year journey that was from Egypt to the Promised Land. And so when he was called back and went to Galilee, he did that. He did that journey. Why? Because he had to identify with everything and fulfill every prophetic word, every prophetic gesture. Are you still with me? Just a couple minutes and I'm done. But listen, this is really important. Ironically, Jesus had to do this. He had to take the journey. And the other part is Nazareth. So the Bible says he would come from Nazareth. Matthew 2:23 says, and he came and dwelt in a city called Nazareth. This is after Egypt. That it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophets, he shall be called a Nazarene. Well, how's he going to be from Nazareth, Bethlehem, in Egypt? But Jesus was from all three of those hometowns. Jesus was from all three. Why? Because he had to fulfill every verse, of 2,500, 2,500 different prophecies in the Old Testament. Jesus had to fulfill, he had to thread that needle of every one to fulfill all righteousness. It made me wonder, what do we know about the childhood and youth of Jesus from the Word and not from tradition? Because the Bible doesn't give us a lot about his childhood or his youth. It doesn't tell us if he, it doesn't tell us if he turned, Kool-Aid into wine. That's a joke. Are you awake? Wow, you guys are really out today. I might do this over second service. Wow. It doesn't tell us why Mary knew he could turn water into wine. I don't know if he turned, water into milk so he could have Rice Krispies. I don't know what he did. I'm just telling you, the Bible doesn't tell us all that. We don't need to know all that, but it does tell us some things. It tells us about his birth. It tells us he was born in a barn. I always think it's because God wanted his son to have a stable environment. Thank you. By the way, weird religious tradition will tell you that they were in that barn because they didn't have any money. That's not what the Word says. The Word says there was no room in the inn. Don't ever forget that. I've heard some people recently talking about, that Jesus, didn't have, he was so poor, he didn't have anything, he was homeless. He wasn't homeless. He had gold, frankincense, and myrrh to get to Egypt and get the journey. Journeys cost money. God provided through the wise men from the east that brought gifts. Think practically. Don't think religiously. Think pragmatically. God cares about every detail. God took care of them, and if he took care of them to get them around, he's going to take care of you too. Amen? He's going to take care of you too. Quit worrying about finance. Quit worrying about money. Understand, his birth right there. His parents, listen, you don't think about it this way, but Mary was a teenager. She was a young virgin maiden, and she was probably about 14 to 16 years old. This was a teen pregnancy, and it was a scandal. Why? Because she hadn't known a man yet, but everybody's going to think she did. Yeah, pregnant, yeah, immaculate conception, right. Even Joseph was like, okay, I'm out, until an angel came and said, hey, she's telling you the truth. She will carry Jesus, the Savior of the world, and you will raise him. He said, okay, I'm in. They got married, and he didn't get to be with his wife till after she was through her pregnancy, delivery, and all the purification rituals. This guy was some guy. We know this thing. We know this from the Word. This isn't tradition. We know it from the Word. Say amen. Amen. There are probably whispers about her purity. It wasn't easy. Had to be tough. Jesus became known as a carpenter's son. But here's the interesting, this is a cool thing for me, is that the word carpenter in the New Testament is the Greek word technon. Technon, T-E-K-N-O-N. And it doesn't literally mean carpenter. It actually means a stonemason or architect. That Joseph wasn't just a guy. We get all these pictures of Jesus making chairs and tables and stuff. And that's, maybe he did that. But he was a designer of houses, probably. Joseph was like a contractor. He was a stonemason. He was planning the big picture, not just, you know, he might have been whittling a few things here and there, but he wasn't making toothpicks. He was a big picture. Isn't that interesting that Jesus was raised by an earthly father who was showing him how to build the big picture, not what we were taught? Just want to challenge you a little bit today. And finally, this verse really hits me, because we're supposed to follow after Jesus and do what he does. This is the summary of Jesus' childhood and youth. Luke 2:52. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and in favor with man. Jesus had to grow. He wasn't born walking on water. He was born as a baby, dependent on humans to feed him, change him, clothe him. You and I need to keep that in mind, because we need to keep growing too. Jesus had to grow. You need to see yourself in this. You know, I always pick on Chris because he's always up front here. And Chris Farley increased in wisdom and stature. And Chris Farley increased in favor with God and favor with man. That's how you need to see this, because Jesus did it. This is what you are to do, to see yourself in the scriptures, to know what he has called you to do. This is physical stature, spiritual stature, emotional stature, mental maturity. All these things, Jesus had to grow into that. Favor with God, favor with people. That's on your life. Favor. Everybody say favor. You have favor on your life because Jesus drew in favor as well. You have favor. Those of you that work in sales or commission, or you have your own businesses, or you're a manager, you're dependent on other people doing something to trade with you for the success of your company and your career. Can I tell you, God has promised you favor on everything you touch. Favor, favor. That doesn't mean everything goes perfect. It means the best possible outcome. The best possible outcome. Yes, amen. Give God praise. You have favor. Finally, this. Jesus is Lord. He is the Messiah. Many of you know this story, but I want to share it again anyway. C.S. Lewis, perhaps best known for writing the Chronicles of Narnia and many other things, was an Oxford medieval literature scholar. He was an atheist, didn't believe in God. He began searching the Bible to prove that Jesus wasn't Lord, that it was all a concoction, that it was all a story. And he ended up getting saved and becoming a great Christian statesman of the faith. His stories of Narnia, many of them, are types and shadows of the picture of Jesus, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and his coming kingdom. The lion, Aslan, and lion, witch, in the wardrobe, particularly. But he said this. This is a great quote. I am trying here, C.S. Lewis said toward the end of his life, to prevent anyone saying the really foolish thing that people often say about Jesus, that I'm ready to accept Jesus as a great moral teacher, but I don't accept his claim to be God, the Messiah. That is the one thing we must not say. A man who was merely a man and said the sort of things Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. He would either be a lunatic on the level with a man who claims to be a poached egg, or else he would be the devil of hell. You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman or something worse. You can shut him up for a fool. You can spit at him and kill him as a demon, or you can fall at his feet and call him Lord and God. But let us not come with any patronizing nonsense about his being a great human teacher. He has not left that open to us. He did not intend to. That's not an option for us. Now it seems to me obvious that he was neither a lunatic nor a fiend. And consequently, however strange or terrifying or unlikely it may seem, I have to accept the view that he was and is God. My friends, C.S. Lewis said, and he's right, people want to compare Jesus with Gandhi or Confucius or this people or the Buddha, fat belly himself. They want to compare him with all this other stuff and say, well, I can believe he lived and he was a good man. C.S. Lewis said we have three options. He was either a lunatic, a liar, or Lord. Are you feeling overwhelmed this holiday season? So many running around trying to get last minute gifts. Let's get back to the simplicity of Christ. Believing in him. Trusting in him. And receiving his promises as our own. My friends, if he's Lord, it's time to bow the knee. It's time to surrender. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today. Your promises are real. Your promises are true. And we thank you today that we know you as Lord and Savior. Lord, I pray for every person hearing the sound of my voice, whether it's watching online or in this room. And I pray in the name of Jesus that you would give us that opening moment into our hearts, that you would turn the light on in every area that's been darkened, in every area that's been muddy or fuzzy, or that we couldn't see or understand, that Jesus is with us, walking with us, sharing his word, his promises with us. Lord, I take authority over the spirit of doubt and unbelief in the name of Jesus. We break the power of it, and we pray that you would open the eyes of anyone this morning and second service and tonight, especially tonight, Father, that you would open the eyes of those coming in looking for us to say that Jesus was a good man, or give them some fables to believe. But today and tonight, we look to the word of God that we can hang our hat on. We look to the living word, Jesus, to enlighten us, to show us the way forward, to lead us in the paths of your lordship. And we call upon the people to surrender to the glorious one, the loving one, the Lord Jesus himself. Amen. Quick, just a thought here. A story I read years ago about a missionary to New Guinea. He went to a cannibal tribe, and they were ready to make, you know, to invite him for breakfast, if you know what I mean. They're ready for to destroy, to kill this guy. And he was trying. He started trying to translate their language, and get the Bible where they could understand their language. So he started translating, and some people started working with him. And they, in their language, there's no word that explained faith. There's no way he could explain belief or faith. And so one day, he was really pondering this because he just couldn't get through to them that they needed to really give their lives to the Lord. And he walked in the room, and one of the translators that was helping him was leaning back on a chair on two legs. And he looked at the guy. He said, "What is that you're doing right now? What is that? How are you so confident in these legs that it's going to hold you? And you're leaning back. What's the word for that?" And he gave him some kind of word that meant leaning, to lean one's full weight upon. And he translated that phrase into the word of God, and people started getting saved left and right. Today, that whole tribe is no longer cannibals. Today, that tribe is saved and serving God because of one phrase that they learned. And I want to say to you, this surrender we're talking about is not you going through emotion and just praying a prayer. I want you to pray the prayer, but it is to lean your full weight upon him as the Lord of your life. If you're here today, you don't know him as Lord, this is the moment to surrender and say, Jesus, I need you. Come into my life. Forgive me my sin. I repent. I've been trying to do it myself. I've been leaning on me. I've had my own Trinity, me, myself, and I. Today I need Father, Son, and Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ. If that's you, just slip your hand up right now. We want to pray for you real quick before we go. Just put your hand up real quick if that's you. If you need the Lord right there. There's someone praying right there. Anybody else I can pray for? This is the moment. This is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day of salvation. Tonight I'm believing for dozens to respond. Would you agree with me right now? I'm going to pray with the person who raised their hand back there. Just say this. Everybody say this at home right now. Say, Jesus, I give you my life. I put my full weight of trust and lean upon you for salvation, for healing, and for wholeness. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You received that word today? Give the Lord a great hand clap. Come on. I love this particular Sunday because we'll do something in just a minute. We do every year. But if you need to give today, if you want to give today, we want to thank you for your giving. I want to encourage you. Usher, stand up. If you need an envelope or an I gave card for electronic giving and want to participate, it's great. Pastor Nikki Gumbel says that Malachi, as the final prophetic statement before 400 years of silence, is a return, as a call to the to a return to the Lord. It's a call for people to get right with God. In particular, Malachi deals with getting your giving sorted out, getting your giving in line, getting your giving in proper alignment. It's a big deal. Because Nikki Gumbel says this, your attitude towards money is a barometer of your whole outlook on life. Like I said, Benny Hinn is the most generous person I ever met. And he's blessed upon blessed. What about your life? What are you holding back? We want to say another huge thank you to everyone who participated in generous giving this year. This has been one of our best years ever. And I think the greatest thing you need to know is this has been one of the biggest giving years we've had. I want to go ahead and start. I don't know how many slides we have back there, but if you can have the slides put up. This is where we've been giving this year. Let me just get out of the way right there. This is our giving for 2023. These are all the ministers. Wait a minute, go back. So these are ministries, pastors, guest speakers, helping start churches. Pastor Joshua Jurjevich, I'm going to be with him at the end of February. We're helping to start a church in Amsterdam, in Holland. It's going to be a great opportunity. So we've been sowing there. We had Joe Monaco come in and do some stuff with us. Anyway, all those great people. Go ahead to the next one. This is our missionaries around the world that we've been supporting faithfully this year and helping them to prepare, helping them to stay strong. Go to the next one. This is local ministries. Some people say, oh, you give so much to missionaries in the world. You don't do anything locally. Can I tell you, that's just such a lie from the pit of hell. We not only support Pay It Forward, Interfaith for the Homeless, Women's Pregnancy Center, Fire Rescue Support. We've been helping to start a chaplaincy program for Marion County firefighters because we had so many firefighters committing suicide or going through depression at the beginning of 2023. They reached out to churches. And we said, yes, count us in. So we've been helping support. Give God praise. You've been helping support a chaplain for the firefighters. That's tremendous. Firefighters Youth Fund, we've been helping. Feed the Fearless is Mojo's First Responders Outreach. The Rock Program is Essential Needs for Students. Heart of Florida Youth Ranch, as you know, we've been supporting. Go to the next one. This is Nationwide International Ministries. Convoy of Hope. Every time there's an international crisis, we've been able to sow and get food and water right in within a day or two into some of the areas affected by tornadoes, hurricanes, and all kinds of disasters. Gideon's we support. Asbury University, where they had the revival, began earlier in the year. American Bible Society, Jesus Way Ministries in Tennessee. Mario Murillo came to Ocala. We supported him. LA Dream Center, Prison Fellowship. We've been doing a lot lately with Tim Tebow Foundation. He's doing a lot now, not just for special needs people, but even for the whole thing of human anti-human trafficking. Tremendous thing. Your giving every week goes to all this stuff. Is there another one? Is there more? Heart Smile. So that's not even Heart Smile. That's just through the tithes and offerings of the church and our boxes. This is Heart Smile Foundation. Look at all these things. We've helped all, we can't even tell you all the stories this year of job loss and emergency financial hardship in benevolence. Funerals we've helped. People that didn't have money to pay for a funeral. Hospital care. Cancer recovery process. Widows. I mean, over 150 families blessed in 2023 through Heart Smile Foundation. Thank you to those of you who support Heart Smile every month. Give yourselves a hand right there. Tremendous. What a great... Listen to this. We did that while building a building. That's what we did. That's what you did while building a building. I wouldn't have believed it was possible 10 years ago. To God be the glory. But we want to say a huge thank you. We pray according to Malachi that God will open the floodgates of heaven and pour out such blessings, wisdom, knowledge, understanding, that you won't even be able to contain it all, not just material things, but in every way. How about joy? How about the it's more blessed to give than to receive? That thing keeps traveling around the world. And I just, when we compile this at the end of every year, I'm just kind of blown away by what we did each week and how it piled up, taking something maybe you felt was insignificant and something I felt was small, putting it together and making a difference worldwide and locally. Let's pray. One, Father, we give you the honor and the glory and the power, for every provision is yours. Everything that we've been able to give is because you blessed your people. You poured out your spirit on us, in us, and through us. We now ask you for a mighty harvest, a harvest of souls, a harvest of faith, hope, and love, a harvest of great joy and blessing. Pour out your spirit upon this congregation. Thank you for the faithful. Thank you for the generous. Thank you for those who have a revelation and the light bulb moment of making a difference by doing something right here in Ocala to make a difference to change the world. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Thank everybody. We want to thank you, appreciate you. You're making a difference. Praise God.
That's fantastic. And just a few announcements. As the ushers are helping to serve you there. I don't know, man. You know, I got to say, this is one of my favorite things of the year, seeing what we're able to do together. That is just awesome. So first announcements I have tonight at 6 o'clock, of course, you know, is our special Christmas. It's our presentation. It's our cookie party as well, too. So I want to make sure that you know, please bring your cookies. If you brought your cookies today, that's great. We'll go ahead and set them up. But if you want to bring them this evening, you can bring that in as well, too. We're going to be gathering in the Legacy Building first until we have everything set up for the presentation. Then we'll be opening this building and then have you come on in. And it's going to be a great time. Then we're going to go over and have some cookies and have some really cool Christmas carols. It's going to be a great time tonight. So next Sunday, as Pastor Richard said, is our Christmas Eve Sunday service. That is going to be one service at 10 a.m., not 9 and 11. So when's our service? You got it. Okay. So it's going to be great. And ladies, Pastor Gail would like to invite you to join her for Pastor Sharon Kelly's devoted conference at Wave Church in Virginia Beach. The dates are going to be Thursday, February 29th through Saturday, March 2nd. The guest speakers are Lisa Turkhurst and Christine Kane. If you're interested, please see Pastor Gail. She's going to be over in the next building in just a few minutes, right there in the lobby. So please meet her there, or you can email her at pastorgail@nowchurch.com. All right, go ahead and stand up. Be blessed. Hopefully we will see you tonight's service. All right, see you soon.
Thanks for joining us at Now Church. For the latest updates, visit us at nowchurch.com, including live or on-demand video, event registration, online giving, and much more. And don't forget to follow Now Church on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag NowChurch. Thank you.